Well, as we saw earlier, broadcaster Heather du Plessis-Allan's comments on her Wellington radio show recently has angered many in our community. I think that's really an understatement. She berated the Prime Minister for going to the forum, Pacific Forum, saying the Pacific doesn't matter and that they're nothing but leeches on us. Joining us now to talk about the leeches comment, and not forgetting that this week we're also looking at women's suffrage as well. It's our first Pacific woman MP and staunch community leader, Luamanuvao Dame Winnie Laban, and Leilani, Tamu, a former New Zealand diplomat and author. Thank you both for joining us on the program.
Thank you.
First of all, when you heard about these comments that were said on radio, the leeches comment, first of all, Luamanuvao, what did you think?
Well, you know, I think about our people, and I think about an ancestry and culture of diplomacy and respect and courage, and how important it is when we hear these comments that we actually stand up and say, no, it's not okay. And we can do it in a very Pacific way that still maintains relationship and our humanity, but also to stand up to abuse of all kinds. And Pacific people are very capable of doing that.
I mean, I was quite surprised how almost everyone in our community was online and talking about it. And Leilani, what did you think as well when you first heard it?
I would have thought about what my grandmother would have said if she's still alive, and she would have said, that woman's a leech, and I'd like to cook the leech for dinner.
And it's so much ignorance, though, in what was said in terms of what New Zealand actually gains from the Pacific.
Mm. Well, you know, New Zealand is a Pacific nation, and New Zealand has a long historical connection with many of the Pacific countries. New Zealand is powerful and strong globally because of the Pacific contribution, whether that be the arts, sports, media, politics. And we're part of the New Zealand fabric. And we need to remind people we just didn't land from Mars. We are an integral part of New Zealand being a Pacific nation.
Leilani, you were a former MFAT diplomat working in the Pacific and seeing some of the AIDS programs that were delivered. Mm. You know, people were saying, oh, you know, this money shouldn't be put there, or perhaps it's not being governed properly. What would you say in terms of why we should be giving aid to the Pacific?
Well, the first thing I'd say is that we have to look at development, or some people refer to it as aid in a broad context, but development funding in the wider history of the Pacific. Our people, our islands, didn't come to be in the state that they're in by accident. Actually, there's a huge colonial history here, and if you look at the history of the region, the reason that actually our health and education systems are in such a poor state is often because those colonial imperial governments that came in the 19th century treated us like less, treated us as inferior, and so actually we weren't given opportunities to make decisions about where funding went way back when. And so what's happening now, post-independence and decolonisation, is actually now we're finally being given the opportunity to make those decisions. And we have, yes, great partnerships with countries like New Zealand and Australia, which we appreciate, but they are partnerships. And so when you're on the ground and you see the impact it has on children's education, you see the impact it has on clean water and sanitation, then you realise how critical it is. We're still catching up. The things that were done to our people over the last 200 years, we didn't do them to ourselves. You know, these are great, powerful nations who did these things. And so when someone like Heather du Plessis-Allan says awful things like that, it shows a level of ignorance, I think, of that history and that context within which we're actually sitting right now.
And in terms of the Pacific needing New Zealand also needs the Pacific. If we look at, you know, this Pacific reset, $1 billion being given to the Pacific, but New Zealand businesses are gaining $1.5 billion last year, almost one and a half billion the year before. New Zealand's benefiting from the relationship.
Yeah, well, maybe we can put it into context. First of all, over 70% of Pacific people living in New Zealand are New Zealand born, so it's young and a fast growing population. Secondly, New Zealand exports to the region over $1 billion worth of goods and services. So what is the return? I mean, I just came back from Papua New Guinea, $250 million of exports to PNG, and PNG do 11 million the other way. So there's a huge imbalance. That, I mean, our people contribute. This is the thing. We're not putting our hand up for hand-ups. We have contributed enormously to this country, economically, socially, culturally, and so it's about time we get reciprocated.
Mm. The sad thing is, though, she's saying comments like these that perpetuate stereotypes, and she's got a platform. People who don't understand the facts are going to believe it.
Mm. Mm. One thing I'd like to say too, I thought it was fascinating that the woman said Nauru was a hellhole, and I thought to myself, yeah, you know, the reason it's a hellhole is because actually New Zealand and Australia mined phosphate from that island, and actually our dairy and agricultural industry over the 1950s and 60s was heavily reliant on that phosphate, and so a lot of our wealth is actually contingent on that island being a hellhole. So how ignorant is that? So when I think about it, yes, I think this woman is actually, to me, she is indicative of a part of our society. The words that she's saying are so hurtful. You know, our kids don't need this. Our kids are already grappling with, like, huge levels of institutionalised racism embedded within systems that they are trying to survive. And then someone like that says that. It's like a level of privilege that just makes me feel sick.
I've only got time for one more comment, actually, and I'm sure we're going to continue a lot of this online as well, but women's suffrage this week, what would you like to say in terms of Pacific women, how far we've come, but what else could be done for our women, Luamanuvao?
Well, you know, in 1893, we got women's suffrage in New Zealand, and if you think about our country, I think we've done extremely well in terms of women. You know, I went into Parliament in 1999. We now have four Pacific women in Parliament.
Two in Cabinet?
Two are in Cabinet, and that's wonderful progress. Unfortunately, for the rest of our region, you know, and this was the stats from June this year, 569 members of Parliament representing 15 Pacific independent nations, and only 43 are women. But we can still concentrate on certain aspects like culture, male dominance, our religion, and say, what are the liberating elements of those three tenets that we can support women to be powerful leaders alongside men? And that's good for everyone.
Mm, and it's good to see women like Reverend Setaita Maikuni leading the Methodist Church of New Zealand. So there's some examples there happening within the church.
That's
but a long
right.
way to go too as well.
Yeah, mm. But what we do now is history for our children. That's why it's important.
Thank you both for coming on the program today. We appreciate your comments.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.